We are now live. What is up, y'all? Robert Sykes, KetoSavage.com.
What's up, everyone? We are going over feeding your dog a raw meat diet today.
Feeding your dog a raw meat diet today. So, let's talk about it. Should we let people jump in and give them a little bit of time?
Yeah, give them a second.
All right, so we feed, we pretty much eat the same thing our dog eats. Does that mean we're eating dog food or he's eating people food? I hadn't figured that one out yet. But we have pretty much transitioned Diesel to a full-blown raw food diet. We did this with Jack, too, when we had Jack. Can you talk about Jack a little bit? Little old Jack?
What do you want me to say?
He was how old when we switched him over?
I think he was, it was 2017, so 10? He was pretty old already by the time that we switched him over.
But we could notice a pretty profound difference pretty quickly when we switched him over. He went from being old and crazy and decrepit to just old and crazy.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
But I will say, every time I took him to the vet, they were like, wow, I cannot believe he's 13. I cannot believe he's 15. I cannot believe, like, every time I took him, they were like, his skin or his coat and everything is like so beautiful. Like he seems really, really healthy other than he was old and crazy.
Yeah. And then with Diesel, we got Diesel and the breeder was feeding him like a lamb powderized like sheep milk, lamb milk,
sheep milk, goat's milk,
yeah. Formula and high protein kibbled mix,
eggs and ground beef.
Eggs and ground beef. And then when we got them, I don't even think we used that kibbled mix they gave us. They gave us several pounds of it. Yeah. We probably put maybe three handfuls total. We phased that out super quick and we went right to just feeding him raw meat, raw beef, and a couple raw eggs. And then we throw in some raw liver. Occasionally, Crystal will throw in some homemade yogurt that she's made. What did you use to figure out amounts? Because James here asked how to determine the amount to feed.
Okay, so there's actually a chart for cats and for dogs. It is going to look a little different for a puppy versus a grown adult, a kitten versus a grown cat. And there's a chart on there that actually tell you how much to feed your animal, and it's called My Pet Carnivore. So look up My Pet Carnivore.
It's .com?
Yep. And you can go to the about raw feeding page, and then it actually has a highlight little thing in their wording that says chart, like food chart or something like that. And it'll tell you exactly what to feed them. So it's been actually really helpful because Diesel's growing so quickly that it's like I literally am having to increase his food amount every single week. Like, it's kind of crazy.
We got him. How much did he weigh when we got him?
I think 13 pounds.
He was 13 pounds when we got him, 7 weeks old?
At 7 weeks old.
Yeah. Seven weeks old. And yeah. I think we were feeding him 8 ounces of raw meat twice a day, morning and evenings at that point. And now he's 43 pounds, you said?
43 pounds.
And he's 12 weeks old or 13?
I don't remember.
12 or 13 weeks old.
I think he's 13 now.
13 weeks old. And we're feeding him a pound of raw beef a day. Pound of raw meat in the morning and a pound of raw meat in the evening. So 2 pounds of raw meat a day. Plus, I'll normally throw in a raw egg with each of those feedings. And if we have some liver thaw, we throw in an ounce or two of raw liver with each of those feedings as well. Now, Crystal's about to switch over to purchasing food from My Pet Carnivore. And what is the reasoning behind that?
Okay, so their food, their animal food is not human grade. They do have some things for humans, but it's for animals. So maybe it's a different process, or maybe it's just not as clean. Or I don't really know exactly why it's not for human grade. You can get bulk, some of them come in 1 pound, 2 pounds, or 5 pounds. There's different kinds of meats. You can get beaver, duck, beef, chicken, pork. There's all different kinds of things. However, their grounded blends are already perfectly proportioned for your animal. So it's a 10% organ blend, 10% bone, and 80% meat, like a muscle meat, you know. So it's already perfectly broken down. And that is technically what they would eat in nature. So like if they were out hunting, that is technically what they would be eating out in nature. So they grind everything together. So the bone is in there, the organs are in there, the meat is in there. They grind it all together and they can like put it in a container for you. However, you can get things like a trachea and your dog can chew on it. You can get chunks of meat. So I have, and I just purchased some, but they were out of the ground, already ground stuff. So I kind of had to like get different kinds of things. I got like a tripe mix. I've got spleen. I got some chunks of pork. And you do want to get them some meat that they can actually like gnaw on, because it's actually good for their jaw and it actually is good for like the hormones that help them to digest their foods. You don't want to do just ground stuff. I did just ground stuff for Jack because he literally had like 5 teeth. So he wasn't able to actually eat a lot. So now with Diesels, and we're going to do a little bit of a mixture, but I really want to do things right with him. Like there's things that I would have changed with Jack. I would have given him different minerals and things like that. I wasn't giving him bone. Like there's things that I would have, knowing now, I would have gone back and changed. But I want to make sure with Diesel, he's getting everything that he needs mineral wise. I think a lot of that he can get in from the bones and things like that. But yeah. Oh, thank you. But also, let me just go on one little more thing. So also, what was I going to say? Oh no, I lost it. I just had it at the tip of my tongue there. Go ahead. No, I can't remember.
Also, Diesel eats a whole bunch of sheep poop. So that, disgusting. I don't know what the macros are like on sheep poop, but he eats quite a bit of that. Probably pretty high in fiber.
Okay, so I'm going to start buying from My Pet Carnivore. It's easy. It's simple. A lot of things are already mixed together. However, Ellen also has a dog and she used to feed her other dog that she had previously a raw diet. And she hasn't switched this dog over to a raw diet. So we just talked about it yesterday, I think, about getting together actually like once a month or once every 2 months and just like having a meat packaging party, going to town and getting... either getting from town or ordering online different, like exactly what we need, some bones, some ground or some bones, some meat and some
organs.
Thank you. And then just doing it ourselves. She used to grind the bones herself. So we can easily do that and just stick it all in a grinder and then just have a meat packaging party. She used to do it for her other dog. She used to package some up for Jack. She's so sweet because she did that. But I think that it would be really helpful because there would be multiples of us. And then just like getting it done and then everyone can just stick the meat in their freezer. You can package it in the exact amount that you need for every day. So you can just pull out whatever you're gonna need for the week, let it thaw out, and then you can just open it up. So I don't know, super easy, super simple. it is expensive. I will say it is expensive. We're not even going to talk about how much it's going to cost us to feed Diesel, but that's an area that we are willing to spend the money because we really want to take good care of our animals.
Yeah. And like the thing about any conventional dog food, cat food, pet food, you're going to get at any of the, you know, big name pet stores, they're all kibbled versions. You could get like some of the canned refrigerated foods and those are sometimes better, but they've all got a ton of crap in them. And we all know that intuitively be true, but it's kind of deceptive marketing because there's one guy, I forget the name of his company, but I had him on the podcast talking about his keto dog food company. But basically like all of the big brand, dog food companies that are trying to appeal to this wild primitive nature of dogs, they do pretty shoddy marketing. I mean, they've got like a wolf on the package of their dog food bags, but and they try to make it sound like it's really high protein, you know, Oregon ancestral blend. But then you actually look at the ingredient list on the back of the package, and it's all a bunch of processed filler foods. Sometimes they have a higher percentage of protein, but it's like not a high quality protein. They're literally getting the bottom of the barrel of whatever they get from food consumption for human consumption, putting that in dog food, plus a bunch of additional processing and just like starches. Like there's a whole bunch of, I mean, dogs don't need to eat potatoes and green peas, but that is oftentimes some of the primary ingredients in these big name dog food companies. Yeah, when you look at what a dog's digestive tract consists of, I mean, they've evolved from wolves. They didn't eat green peas and potatoes and tubers out in the wild. They would eat meat. The pH of their stomach is more in line to digest and absorb meat and bones and connective tissues, not peas and tubers. Diesel eats really, really fast, like obnoxiously really fast. We've tried to help slow that because, well, I mean, he needs to chew his food better. He has really bad hiccups after he eats, yeah, if he eats super fast. So we got one of those spiraled bowls, and you just like, we'll get the ground beef and we'll like break it up into pieces and put it into all the different spirals. And it takes him considerably longer to eat that. A pound of meat now takes him about 4 minutes, whereas before it took him like 30 seconds.
Yeah, it was like crazy fast how he was eating.
And I know it takes him 4 minutes because he eats the moment I jump into my cold plunge, and he has finished eating as soon as my cold plunge is done, and I'm doing 4 minutes in the cold plunge. So it now takes him 4 minutes to eat a pound of beef with one of those spiral bowl things.
I would recommend that for anyone feeding their dog, especially large dogs that like to eat really quickly. I think it's a lot better for their digestion and stuff.
Yeah. All right. Same for feeding raw food diet for cats.
I think the ratio is what they're talking about.
Yeah.
I think it's the same. I believe it's the same because I think that they just have it broken down for the animal, for all of the animals. There's not like a separate types of food for cat and for dog. But what's really cool about their website too is if you're looking at certain things like, the like tripe, for instance, you're like, oh, okay, is that like considered an organ or is it considered like a meat? Like, so like, should this be in the 80% or like the 10%? It'll actually tell you on there like, hey, feed this to your dog as if it were muscle meat. So make sure to add bone and organs to it. Like it's really helpful. They're super informative. So just go over to their website and check it out. We are not affiliated with them at all. They've just been really helpful for me over the years. super helpful.
And cats are even more carnivorous than dogs. I mean, their stomach pH is even more acidic, I believe. Haven't looked at the pH levels of cats versus dogs in a while, but you know, cats historically are even more on the carnivorous spectrum than dogs. So you definitely don't need to be feeding your cats peas and potatoes. I always love like the vegan memes where they've got like a hardcore vegan that's trying to convince their dog or cat that it's also a vegan, and they'll have like a salad in one bowl and a bunch of meat in one bowl, and they'll just let the animal go to whatever it prefers. And it always goes to the meat because they know what it needs to have optimal nutrition. It ain't a salad.
Greg said he'd be interested in the group packaging for his two dogs, and I'm totally down.
Beautiful, Greg. Well, you can be in our meat packing party.
Yeah, faux show.
Faux show. All right, that is the little jaunt on raw food for pets. Speaking of pets, I am building a massive dog house for Diesel. I've been working on it for a while. It's going to be fully insulated. It's got 2-inch thick insulation throughout. It is literally 10 feet long, has a front covered porch, a tin roof, and all the bells and whistles. And I'm making it that big because when I get in trouble and Crystal sends me to the dog house, I'll be able to be comfortable in that dog house.
That's pretty funny.
All right. What other questions we got? Open table discussion now. So any questions, comments, thoughts y'all have, throw them our way because I'm keen to just chit chat. We weren't on last week's Live at 5, so our apologies there. We were coming back from the eclipse. We had a little eclipse viewing party at our family farm.
That was like 2 weeks ago.
I know. I was looking at the schedule and I was like doing my daily journaling, catching up on a few days because I had missed writing it. And I'm like, okay, what all happened last week? And it was the eclipse last week.
That's crazy.
Yeah, not even, that's like a month ago.
Yeah.
Anyways, yeah, so open table discussion, y'all. Anything you got, throw it at us.
Give me some good questions. I woke up my son for this.
Yes. did you take that meat out of the thaw? Speaking of meat, is it about the same weight as the last one? Probably.
I have no idea.
I got some stew meat waiting on me for dinner tonight.
I pulled out two so we can have one too.
What are y'all going to have? Like, how are you going to cook it?
I don't know.
Eggs again?
Probably not.
We've been rocking the Egg Life wraps. Anybody that has not had the Egg Life wrap, you don't know what you're missing. If you like tortillas, tacos, breakfast burritos, things like that, the Egg Life wraps are pretty freaking good.
They're so good.
Super clean ingredients. Mm-hmm.
They're a little pricey, so I really try not to buy them. Yeah. But Robert's parents, we thought they were going to come up last weekend. And so I got them to make like wraps with like meat and veggies and, you know, things like a cold wrap. But they didn't. So now we've just been like devouring them.
We have a bunch left?
No.
They are really good. And I'm all about changing texture. We haven't done chaffles in a while. I haven't had that.
I know. I've been thinking about doing chaffles.
We could do chaffles. We got any questions coming in? We got people jumping on the lives, but no questions coming in. So open format discussion here, y'all. Throw it at us. All right, we got one. Boom, Kayla's the winner. With your sleep schedule, do you adjust if with the seasons and sunlight, or is it just always 3 a.m. and that's the time that you go with? Not sure if Arkansas follows daylight savings. Arkansas is one of those weird places that does do daylight savings.
One of the weird, like most of the U.S. does.
I know, it's all weird if you do daylight savings. But yes, we pretty much, Crystal actually just started waking up at 3 to start working out early in the morning.
Yeah.
But yeah, for me, it's pretty much just 3 o'clock, regardless of the time. I definitely prefer the longer daylight hours in the evening. I get a lot more done, but it's kind of weird switching from a circadian rhythm standpoint. I would love to get to a point in life where I could just wake up with the sun and go to sleep with the sun, but I've got too much to do to justify that at this current chapter in my life. But I think that is 1,000% the optimal way to go about it. We're inundated with so much. Yeah. We're just inundated with so much artificial light these days that it's so far removed from what we've been accustomed to as a species for the majority of our existence. It would be nice to kind of return to that, but I'm not yet retired. James says, I brought back eggs 2 weeks ago, had to stop due to psoriasis. Finally calming down. Love eggs.
Dang it.
Interesting. I got an employee that has really bad psoriasis, and he's gone super strict carnivore, and he's cut out like a lot of the seasonings, like garlic, pretty much any seasoning really, but like garlic, onion-based seasonings especially, and he says that's helped quite a bit, but he eats a lot of eggs, so I wonder if that's the missing link.
I don't know.
So you notice a specific improvement just from removing eggs?
I think it's what's inflammatory to your body. So, like, he could cut out eggs and see if that's a thing. My sister is sensitive to eggs, but she didn't find out until she was, like, 34 or 30, however old she is, 32. I don't know.
I eat a lot of eggs. I have a hard time cutting out eggs. Indigo Nilly has a great recipe to make your own egg white wraps. Yeah, oh, Greg, yeah. He's on the Instagram here. He's been a competitor of Egg Life for a while, and he's hacked their recipe and posted about making it.
Partially makes me not want to make it though, because I create a product, so I kind of like want to support people who are like trying to make a product, you know?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't know. At the same time, I try to make things cleaner. So like, if I can make it cleaner than the ingredients have.
Theirs is pretty clean though. Like they don't have.
I know, that's what I mean. So like, yeah. I want to keep supporting the people who are doing things right in the world out there. So like our grocery stores are more filled with that stuff.
Yeah. James says, I went carnivore a year ago with meat only and got rid of the psoriasis, dandruff, and dry skin, going back to meat.
Oh, interesting.
That is interesting.
Hey, from Canada. Love the little story of the stories of Puppy Diesel. Great family ad. Thank you. We're pretty happy with him. He's pretty great.
He is pretty great. He's becoming an outside dog though, for sure. We got a load of gravel last week to try and fill the void between the fence or the bottom of the gate and the driveway, so he couldn't crawl out of that. And there's a couple low spots we got to fill in right now. But once that's done and the dog house is finished, he will officially be an outside dog.
Yep. if he spends a day home at home with me, he's outside. Yeah. 90% of the time.
But honestly, he doesn't like ever run away. Like he's super chill in that regard. Like he doesn't ever venture too far from us.
He wants to hang out around the house.
Yeah, he's been hanging out on the front porch and like he goes and grabs limbs and logs and bones and stuff and brings them to the front porch. So we have like a pretty eclectic group of random findings accumulating on our front porch.
Yeah, including pulling my front porch rug out to the grass.
Yeah, well, you got to keep it interesting. All right, anything else, y'all? Any other comments, thoughts, questions? I'm about to jump on the live for my coaching group. I got my beta testing coaching group members that I'm going to jump on live for here in just a little bit. And we're going to be diving into muscle building on a ketogenic diet. So I'm excited to chat about that. James says, do you find it easier to drop weight when strict keto or when strict high fat, moderate protein? So with my cutting protocol, I start at a very high fat ratio, but then I increase protein while dropping fat until I find my own protein threshold. And at the top of that threshold, my protein in grams oftentimes exceeds my fat in grams, not in calories, but in grams. So I'm relatively higher protein at that point. And then from there, I start dropping my protein. So my fat ratio does increase going forward. But there is a point in my prep protocol in which my protein is relatively high compared to my fat. But yes, generally speaking, my fat ratio is always higher than protein. It always is as a percentage of total calories. It not always is as it relates to grams. Kayla says, how do you calculate how much caloric surplus for building phase? It really just kind of depends on a couple of different factors. Everyone's going to have a caloric threshold, so to speak. And when you're in a caloric surplus, you're going to be more prone to put on body fat because you're just simply more prone to putting on more tissue in general. So you need to be in a surplus to build more muscle optimally. And the degree of that surplus is going to be dependent upon a few things. One of which is how much fat you're willing to gain in a building phase and how well your body is recovering and responding to that increase in training load. So if you're increasing calories and you're continually seeing progress in the gym and you're adding more lean tissue, then I would keep being aggressive with that surplus. If you start to notice at any point that you are accumulating more fat tissue relative to lean tissue and you're not seeing any improvements in your training performance, then that's kind of like the point of diminishing returns. There's no reason to increase calories much beyond that. So that's going to be a little bit different for everybody. I'm at a pretty aggressive surplus right now. I'm consuming like 5,000 calories a day on average, which is pretty high for me. Doesn't feel that high because I could put down 5,000 calories super easy. But anything beyond that, I'm not really going to see a relative increase in lean tissue to body fat. Like I'm just going to start putting on unnecessary body fat and no really need to do that. We got anything on the IG?
Nope.
Nothing on the IG. All right, yo. Well, that might be all she wrote. Do we have a topic for next week's live?
Nope.
Rigel said nope, too. Well, in that case, ladies and gents, when the vlog's coming back? Good question.
That's a Robert question.
I was talking to Crystal about this yesterday. I'm all about doing the vlogs. I love the vlogs. We kind of want to do the vlog so we can document Rigel growing up more because we don't want to miss being able to look back on that 10, 20, 30 years from now. So we're going to bring back the vlogs, but I need to get everything updated and launched and polished with all the business endeavors first so that I've got more mental bandwidth to tackle the vlogs because the vlogs, like vlogging, especially if you're doing daily vlogs, is a pretty intensive process. So I don't know if we'll do daily vlogs or if we'll do like weekly vlogs, but we will bring the vlogs back.
Maybe I should just start.
Maybe. But there's a lot of things that we're doing on the personal side behind the scenes that we would like to vlog that we think is super exciting, entertaining stuff. A lot of the homesteading stuff. So we're going to bring that back. It may just be another month or two.
Yep. We stopped show like putting Rigel's.
Kayla
like,
says love vlogs.
Yay.
We'll bring them back, I promise.
We really stopped showing Rigel's face so much on Instagram and Facebook, but we are like, he's still on our YouTube channel. And that's really like, that's the place it's going to be documented, you know? So I really do want to get those started back up because we're missing some of it. Definitely missing them and looking forward to it. Felt like I was a part of the family a few years back, lol. Yeah. I know. It's like such a bummer. Like, I feel like now looking back over like the last year, I'm like, wow, we've really dropped the ball on that. And like, we have not done a recipe video since Rigel was born. The last ones we did, I was huge pregnant with him.
Yeah.
Like, that's crazy. Like,
we got to do that.
But Robert's been so busy with like his prep and doing the course and writing the book and doing all these things. Like, on the other aspect of things, like, I really should just like start filming. But I'm not very good at like bringing it full circle. Like, hey, this is the beginning of our day. Now what?
I'm probably pretty rusty.
Rigel and I are going to the park, you know?
I'm probably pretty rusty at the vlogs since it's been so long. For a while there, I mean, I did consistently a daily vlog for,
well,
it was over 100 days. Like, I think it was like 200 days or something crazy.
Okay, let's chat about this. You guys tell us, what are your favorite things to see on vlogs? Like, what's your favorite aspect that we could show you that you would like? Is it just like the day to day, like what we're doing? Is it like our schedule and our routine? Is it our food? Is it just a mixture of all of the above? Do you like the weekend vlogs versus like a, what does our life look like during the week? You know, what is the most interesting aspects of things?
Yeah.
Do you guys want to know when everything goes wrong in the business and all you see is Robert going like this all day?
There are definitely a lot of days like that, especially right now. There's a lot of things going on with the business right now. Kayla says all of it. Yes.
All of it.
I remember recipe vlogs on the blackboard of your apartment.
Oh my gosh, that's so funny.
That is very OG indeed.
I will look back at sometimes because I'll have like clients ask me for video or for recipes and stuff. And I will look back at some of those and I'm like, oh my gosh, like these are so old and like so cringy sometimes.
Yeah, but that's the coolest thing. Like, we started documenting the journey and creating content before we had any professional photography skills or video skills. We still don't have any of those professional skills, but now I've got a full-time media guy, which makes the quality of the content way better. But I like the vlogs because it's just total run and gun style. You capture the emotion. Sometimes it's not all clean and crisp and professional, but that's the whole point of vlogs. Like, it's just raw and real. So we'll bring those back for sure. I promise.
I personally like it all. Gym, food, day in the life, family, and homesteading.
Yeah. We will have a lot more homesteading content to document for sure. We've got like our sheep. We're going to butcher those at some point. I want to vlog all that. I want to vlog building a barn, building a shop, all that good stuff. Talk about a flashback. I was introduced to y'all when you had an interview with Keto Connect like 6 years ago.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, that is definitely a blast from the past for sure. I haven't talked with them in a while. I need to check in and see how they're doing. Are they even making content anymore? I haven't looked. But I'm curious. Has he got a mud butt?
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
Oh, that's an exciting thing. We're going to potty train at the end of this month.
Yeah, we can
like,
do
that's like next week. I'm pretty. Next week? Is that next week? I think that might be next week.
Yeah, it's getting close. Recipes equals simple is best. Homesteading for sure. Yeah, I really want to tap into the homesteading stuff. And like, we haven't been able to vlog homesteading stuff before now because we lived in an apartment. We lived in the warehouse for 3 years. Like, we couldn't really do that. But now we've got a little bit of land. We're trying to like raise our own animals. So it's very, very fitting time-wise.
In Michigan, making homesteading content, but not much. Keto Connect, that is. Oh, they're in Michigan.
I didn't know they were making homesteading content.
That's Michigan. I would never have assumed that.
Yeah, we should definitely reach out to them and see how they're doing. We need to like have them on and talk about homesteading. Will you be at Hack Your Health? Yes, I'll be speaking on two different panels at Hack Your Health. I'll be speaking on the entrepreneur panel, which I think is on Thursday. And then I'm also going to be speaking on the food addiction panel. I'm not sure what day that one is. But yes,
Rigel and I are not sure if we're going or not.
They are in the debate. All right, Joe, I'm going to jump on to that other live from my coaching group. Much love to y'all. Thank y'all for tuning in. And we will figure out a topic for next week. And we'll let you know what that is.
And maybe I'll record a vlog for y'all.
Maybe. We're actually going to go visit my grandparents this weekend. Yeah. But we might actually capture some vlog footage while we're at it. So stay tuned for that. All right. Take care, y'all. Much love. Have an amazing week. Ta-ta for now.
See ya.